class from what might exist in a few quarters to what is in the plan for the next few years between the flash and the SRAM spec, and how the ReRAM compare with that for the embedded memory applications. And it's mostly, and you will see that most of the advantage is about the energy and the cost. Cost is driven by a lot of different factors. It has to be in a fab. The stack should be simple. The time to process should be simple. The tools that you use should be standard, and so on. And also the cell has to be small. In terms of energy, getting to below 0.5, 0.2 picojoule per bit. This is also one golden nugget that we have. Nobody has this ultra low power ReRAM, and you will see the benefits that it brings to the machine vision community. This is because of the ultra low power characteristics of crossbar ReRAM. These memories are used across different platforms, and even within the computing platform, if you look to a data center, for example, you have the CPU business, which is probably 98% owned by Intel with the x86. But now you have all these new computing platforms, especially for AI. You have the AI training platforms that was also kind of initiated by the NVIDIA's GPUs and FPGAs and very high-end, high-performance computing cores. And now you have new companies going into this segment with GraphCore, Calray, Habana, and others. There's also another class of AI just for inference, and I think Google also pioneered this with the TPU, having a dedicated ASIC only for these specific applications to run inference model in the cloud. And these computing platforms demands different memory needs. For example, the CPU needs SRAM and HBM, NAND, DRAM, all the class of technologies. For the AI training, it's also high performance, SRAM based and HBM. Today, this is what they use today. When you go to inference, and especially when you go to inference as a cloud, it's also a different beast, not only on the computing, but also on the memory side. Computing platform is also coming from different companies. You have Intel Morpheus, you have GeoFalcon, you have Halo, and others, new company going into this market of AI inference at the edge. And also have different requirements for energy and latencies and cost. And the ReRAM and crossbar ReRAM is addressing all these segments from two different angles. We start with AI inference at the edge because of these ultra low power characteristics that we have fundamentally with the technology. So this is the best technology for AI inference at the edge. But we see some traction in the AI inference in the cloud and going up in this segment. But also for the SCM, with this selector technology that we have, we also see some traction from the high-end data center computing cores to address this market. So let's go now to more specific AI and machine vision applications. So this is a typical face recognition, object recognition, neural network architectures, where you take inputs from sensors, could be a camera, could be a microphone, could be whatever you need, or whatever you have in terms of sensors. And these inputs, let's say the question of the picture, if it's a camera, you will run it through a neural network. And the objective and the application of this neural network is to extract features. Extracting features is to have a digital view of an image. So from one picture of my face, I will have 128 bytes. From one picture of a full landscape, I will have another vector or object that is a representation of what my camera saw. And this is the job of neural network. This is not what we are doing at Crossbar. Because we realize that first, there's a lot of company who's doing that, and some of them are doing the job pretty well. But the problem is not only on this part. It's what to do with this object, what to do with these features. Today, you push it back to the main CPU and say, okay, now tell me what it is. Run this classification phase. What is it? Is it a car? Is it a pedestrian? Is it something? And usually it's not done by the neural network hardware accelerator. It's done by the main CPU to check from one input or multiple vectors, what is a class, what is a database heat that you have. And sometimes you can spend three times the time on this last phase compared to the whole process. So this is one of the major bottlenecks of current neural network architecture. So we looked at this problem and we talked to some customers and we came up with these architectures to use a ReRAM array, ReRAM cell, sorry, and to build a very specific, very high performance wide memory array. Here we built a 50 gigabyte per second memory access from ReRAM, non-volatile and very low energy when you read. That's why you can do 50 gigabyte per second in such an efficient way. But not only that, we also integrate logic in the ReRAM IP. So within the array, you have not only the data part, but also the logic part. So the near memory computing architectures using logic and memory, because ReRAM and crossbar ReRAM is a CMOS compatible technology. We are targeting embedded memory. So instead of licensing the memory block, we are integrating some logic, or we're actually building the logic ourselves, and package that in an IP that you can use. The beauty of that is, now that the bottleneck is fixed, the 50 gigabytes is handled by crossbar IP in our IP, the rest of the world can talk to us with barely low throughput interface. We're talking 50 megahertz, SPI, USB, or very simple low performance performance. Because from the features at the output of the neural network to this guy, you just have to send the features on a 50 megahertz frequency. What is required is to get very high performance inside the search accelerator. So you can see that as a database search accelerations. All the data sits in the ReRAM. You have one input, you want to have the check. The check will come in a few nanoseconds. And then the logic could be optimized for some application or some customers. You can see a distance computation. So we have a different kind of distance math. You can see other algorithms that you can put, KNN and others. So that's what we are developing and what we have developed. And that's what we have here and that we can see in our booth very, very close. So what we did is also is, okay, if this doesn't exist, what was my option? What are the alternatives for that? Well, the option is, as I mentioned, to send back the features to the main CPU and hope that it will do the job. And don't advertise the numbers and the latency and energy you consume during that phase. So we did some tests and we took a high-end ARM quad-core A53 running at 1.5 gigahertz. We took the also IM DDR4 connected together with all the optimization from this platform, trying to do this feature match, the classification phase. And we compare that with our chip, crossbar chip. And as I mentioned, our chip can run at 50 megahertz because the throughput is internal. And you can see that here, you can get 30x performance improvement using our IP compared to a quad-core ARM and DDR4 running at 1.5 gigahertz. And guess what? We don't consume anything, almost 500x less energy because it's non-volatile, because the data sits here. You don't move the data. Remember how I start. You don't want to move the data. If you take a neural network hardware, you take the data, you send it back to the host, you send it back. This is what we saw. Everything sits in our ReRAM IP. And that's also depending on how big are the objects that you want to compare. So we're talking about object lookups per second, or LUPS. How many objects your device is able to detect? How many objects lookups you can do per second? How many object lookups you can do per watt? That's a metric that you should start to ask also your partners in this market. And depending on the size of the objects, because now we have different flavors of neural network. It can be neural networks handling 1K deep objects all the way to small objects. But if you have small objects, you have to compare many of these small objects. So that's also something that's good for us, because you have to get even better into the OLUPS or object lookups per watt. And we can reach all the way to 3 billion object lookups per second in this tiny chip. So this is how we solve the memory bottleneck for these applications. But it doesn't need to be after a neural network. It can be just a database search. It can be indexing. It can be whatever pattern matching that you want to do. So it's more beyond just on the neural network classification phase. It can be also just a way to do a better search on your edge device or even to the cloud. We're not expert in neural network. We're not expert in also these database search acceleration. So we decided to build a consortium with some partners. And GeoFalcon has been one of the key leaders on these to as a provider of neural network acceleration, how we can help them to accelerate the last phase of the classifications. But with other players, robot sensing and NTES, we are the expert of IoT deployments across huge cities or college or university, mainly in Japan and anywhere in the world, helping us to bring these IP, software, hardware IP together and come up with reference platform and joint value proposition, because we all have our domain expertise. Together, we're even stronger to make the message very clear to you. So Scale has been founded a few months ago. We have four funding members. There's already a new one. It's each one i3 3D camera who's willing to join now the Scale consortium. There's other company asking to join, so you will hear more and more about the Scale consortium. The idea is just to make things, build reference platform for machine visions, mostly at the edge today, where you bring the best of the Crossbar IP, the best of JerFalcon IP, the best of other partners IP, and together we can come up with a solution that is ready to go to market. So there's a lot of players who doesn't know a lot about AI. You have camera guys who wants to go in smart camera. You have speaker guys who want to smart speakers. They need also some help. So the idea was, okay, this is the solution. You can take it as is, or we can tweak it for you. So that's the whole idea of Scale. This is also as a summary. Crossbar, as I mentioned, we are very local. We're in Santa Clara, we're about 70 people. We've been created about 10 years ago, raised about $100 million so far on the technology side and on the system side also, bringing this new architecture to you. Leaders in resistive RAM across these two product lines for embedded integrations, for this computing, near-memory computing, and in-memory computing research and developments, and also getting into different foundries available at different process now. This is where we have to discuss under NDA how we can align our roadmap, which fab, which process, because our ReRAM sits in the metal routing layers of the wafer, so we have to port the technology to these foundries, but we already successfully ported to three main foundries, so that's where we have to get some under NDA discussions to get these integrations. Applications, stress-less memory, computing, FPGAs, having non-volatility in FPGAs, having more computing in ASIC, having more computing in some edge and microcontroller for industrial application, automotive, robotics, infrastructure monitoring, manufacturing monitoring. This is what we are working on, and we will be happy to host you some demos at the booth, which is right next after the show here. Thank you very much.
Any questions for Sivan? Please step up with the mic.
First of all, for the HoneyLand, do you have to do write verify?
Sorry, can you?
Do you have to do write verify? After you write, do you have to verify that you wrote the right thing?
No, it's a non-volatile memory. You write once, and then it's there for 10 years, even if you
write it. I didn't mean that. What I have seen, in conferences and stuff like that, in order to write the right thing, you have to write many, many times until you get it right. Once you get it right, it stays.
Not in our case.
You can write
once.
Because what I've seen is that there are RERAMs where basically you keep writing until you get it right. That's another question. In fact, as recent as a few months ago, that's what I was presented at System X symposium at Stanford.
Okay.
They couldn't do that. So it would be interesting to learn some of that. And the other thing is that, what's the density? So for example, like in 1 millimeter square, how many megabytes, gigabytes in there?
So to give you a perspective on this application, we're talking about 3 billion object lookups per second. These 3 billion object lookups, this, at 28 nanometer, it's in 2-3 square millimeter. So it's more than enough that for most of the application in terms of objects. If it's depending on the size of the objects. So this is where we can play and work together. how big is your object? How many classes do you need? How many instances do you need? And that's how you get a square millimeter per piece object. And we can tweak also how many blocks you need for such applications. Because the architecture I described, this can be cascade with others. So we don't have any limitations in terms of how many objects you have. You will always have the same deterministic latencies. And in terms of density, we can pack millions or billions of objects in few square millimeters.
Right. No, I was just trying to compare with the traditional, like, you know, like, for example, if you go look at, like, you know, ISCCC, SRAM, they tell you how many...
Oh, it will be much, much denser than
SRAM.
So
yeah, I'm just trying to get...
When you, and especially when you go SRAM, when you scale,
yes,
and your edge square is getting bigger.
Yeah.
This is a cross-section of two layers. This is a real...
Yes, yes. No, I know.
So this is based on the transistor that you have. So the smaller transistor, the smaller cell you have. So you can back millions of bytes per very tiny array.
I'll give that. But and for the deterministic write,
yeah.
How, I mean, is it like instantaneous? Because for example, I write something, and if I want to change on the fly, because unless I wrote everything and I have access to everything from my processor all at once, I have to rewrite stuff.
So the use case we see back again to the customers is it's really a read intensive application. So use cases, you write your database, and we have a special write bus to write on the database, and this will stay for 10 years. And you can modify that millions of times, by the way, if you want. But most of the case, it's only reads. So we have an 8,000 bit wide bus for reads, and that is sitting very close to the computer. So for we, and but you can update and write back the data.
Which works well for the weights, for example, neural networks. I write the weights, and it stays there. But how the activation that keeps changing? I need to write that.
So here in this example, I'm doing the search of the classes. So this is not the weights that are stored here. This is used for how many classes, is it a cat, is it a dog, is it something else, is it an event I know or an event I don't know. So this is not something that will move. You will update your model maybe once a day. And I don't think you will update your model once a day, it's maybe once a week. So this is not an application that you demands to change the data like the weight. So this is not for the weight storage. For this application, this is more to put the database. For example, we have demos where we want to check faces. So you have a database of faces. One use case, we have a customer who deploy that for a college where they have all the